What's up, guys? Welcome to The Juice once again. This is Jared, and I got my buddy here.
What's up,
Micah
everybody?
Groover. Micah Groover. Today we will be talking Resident Evil 7. So I know we're a little late to the party. The reason why I decided not to do a full review right after I beat it was because I really wanted to get deep inside the lore of the series, and I wanted to talk some spoilers after we give our initial thoughts of the game. So I want to just start this video off by asking Mike over here. I understand, Micah, that this was pretty much your first full just dive into a Resident Evil game. I know we've played Resident Evil 5 co-op occasionally and stuff, but from beating a Resident Evil game beginning to end, what did you think of it? Just initial thoughts.
Man, I thought it was a great game. It was very fun to play. It was a very great experience. They do a great job of making you feel like the character and putting you in the world. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was a really good game and a real fun game to play, especially as a real first time Resident Evil game.
Yeah. And that's awesome to hear, because I think me personally, I love Resident Evil. It's one of my favorite franchises. I've played everyone except maybe Revelations, just because I don't care about that part of the series. So coming in, I understood there was a lot of skepticism towards Resident Evil 7 due to it being first person. People were kind of calling it an Outlast ripoff, similar to like PT and stuff. I was personally optimistic from the get-go. I thought the game was creepy, and that's what it needed to be again. If you look back at Resident Evil 4, 5, and 6, you really seem to notice that it was becoming very much an action game. And Resident Evil 7, for me, is a return to form, 100%. First person is an excellent change to Resident Evil. Absolutely.
Definitely made the game more fun.
In fact, I want the rest. I would love if they do 8 and 9 to be first person as well. The game keeps you on your toes. Though I think the game's a tad too easy. I'm not saying I needed it to be, you know, Madhouse difficulty with normal, but it would have been nice to maybe have, just to keep on your toes a little bit more. Maybe make you manage your inventory a little bit more. Far as the story is it's good for Resident Evil. Capcom really focused on making atmosphere for this game. Rather than trying to give you some like convoluted plot points, it definitely has twists, and it does a great job of, like Micah said, really making you feel like you're in that situation. Because I will say the biggest difference in this game, not really a spoiler, is that instead of being an agent, you know, that is trained similar to Chris Redfield or Claire, you're not trained for these situations. You're not this spec ops like agent. You are a person that is looking for his wife. And when all these crazy things start to happen, he's definitely, this is his first time experiencing these type of things. And that transfers to you also, just because this is the first time you're playing the game. So when you're confused, the protagonist is confused. And that really helps not make you feel kind of like you're out the loop if you're confused, like what's going on. It's all just insanity. And that's what they do well. It boggles my mind that Capcom made this game, to be honest. Current day Capcom, just because with Street Fighter V not doing well at launch, and them kind of showing a couple years ago that, you know, Resident Evil 5 and 6, like, we're going action, and I'm really glad that they took a step back and said, you know, let's go back and really focus on what makes Resident Evil enjoyable. And they did. The puzzles are there. You can hide more, which is amazing. I don't think that those are my favorite moments of the game personally. I don't know about you.
Yeah.
Just being able to hide and having that, the AI is so believable that it really makes you feel like you're hiding from someone in a house. So,
and you have the option to hide or attack.
Yeah, or attack, and yeah, just
however you want to play.
Shoot gun yourself through. And And yeah, so we're about to wrap up the spoiler-free, but basically yeah, we love the game. If you're a Resident Evil fan, I highly suggest you play it. Definitely. If you're not a Resident Evil fan, I would still recommend playing it. It is very much by itself, but I will say the story later on definitely rewards players who are familiar with the lore of the series. So, yes. So now that would be wrapping up our spoiler-free discussion. We are about to delve into spoilers. So if you have not beaten Resident Evil 7 or you just don't care, we are about to talk spoilers. So but with the spoilers, I want to just talk about maybe some of our favorite parts of the game. So my personal favorite part of the game is just the beginning. I guess it could be dubbed the prologue, but basically up until Jack actually kidnaps you and takes you to that real house. Talk about pacing. This beginning sequence from beginning to end is perfectly paced. You show up in this bayou, in this creepy bayou place in Louisiana. All you know is your wife said, "Come get me." Really weird that 3 years later she's all of a sudden saying, "Hey, come get me." You know, you thought she was dead or something, and you know, you're walking through, you see this huge mansion, this plantation-like building. And of course, doors locked, you know, you're walking through, you're seeing the van that the Swamp Gators had, that that Clancy in the demo, which me and Mike can play the demo extensively. And that's another quick thing. The marketing for the game was spectacular. From the demo being really elusive to the trailer literally giving nothing away. Like, people that have beat the game, like, I want to know in the comments, did you get anything from the trailer that you got from the game in terms of spoilers? Because usually, a lot of times in movies and games, you know, the trailers are giving away a lot of key points that you wish you would have experienced. I felt like I was still going in blind with the trailer. So that's kudos to Capcom on that. But back to the prologue. Yeah, you're going in, you find the guest house, and it's actually revealed that the demo space was simply the guest house. It wasn't even the full mansion that you're in. And you know, they switched up some stuff from the demo, but then you find Mia. And your instinct is, oh, it's fine. You know, I'm gonna get Mia out of here. But no. You understand that she's, well, not at the point in that story, but she is infected by Evelyn, and she just goes crazy, starts knifing you. It's really like gruesome and gross, and I know Michael is creeped out, but the when Mia's actually crawling on the stairs, that is terrifying, very Ring-like in that aspect. And it's pretty much that whole prologue with your hand getting cut off and you having to pick it up and just casually get a gun and fight her. It was goofy, but scary at the same time. It had the campy feel. And Resident Evil's always had that camp-like feel to it. It's never been this super realistic, serious narrative. It's always been a campy horror game, you know, with survival elements in it. But that was my personal favorite part of the game. Now, what about you, Micah? What part of the game did you experience that you were like, whoa, like, this is cool?
I'd have to either agree with you about the prologue, because they really do just throw you right into it.
Yeah.
There's nothing, no, like, short period of time or anything. It's just right into the action and the scariness.
Yes, and...
And I'd either say that, or I'd say the first time you fight Jack, in like the little arena with the chainsaw.
Yes.
The chainsaw.
So
I thought that was just fun, just like going after it with each other at chainsaws.
Yeah, and that is such a... I'm glad you brought that up, because I know one thing that people were worried about was, oh, am I just going to be running away from stuff? Because back when the game was previewed, you know, the demo kind of showed an axe. Later on, we got like handgun ammo, but
yeah,
you can fight in this game. But I'm glad it's not the complete focus, because yes, there's obviously boss fights, which you need to kill who you're facing, whether it's Margaret or Jack. But it never feels like, oh, let me just get a shotgun and blast my way through the game.
Yeah.
And yes, that it's a very intimate fight with Jack. Because a lot of, for instance, 5. One thing I didn't like about Resident Evil 5, for instance, and 6. Were that the bosses just felt very, just too big for me. They were always, I never had a kind of an attachment to who I was fighting, just because it's always this crazy tentacle monster or this is like this giant beast that I have no, I don't care about like at all. Whereas Jack is like this enigma that, you know, he's been creeping around this house and surprise, like you're just going to be fighting him in this weird, yeah, weird like arena style gauntlet match with a chainsaw. Yes, and it's so gross. And also, just the scenarios you can get in, like the garage scene where you can either get in the car and run him over or he will literally rip, he'll throw you out and just start spinning around in that car. Like, they did a great job of really keeping you on your toes. Because you genuinely, it's crazy because I'd play through the game twice normal and I'm still chipping away at Madhouse mode, but I knew what was happening and I was still kind of like on the fence. And I feel like that's a good, you know, it's a great linear experience when you're still on your toes of what can happen in a scripted event. And I think those two moments really stand out, even though there's all kinds. I think the puzzles are fantastic. The happy birthday puzzle, though it's kind of simple, I just think it's a very smart puzzle.
I thought all the puzzles were pretty simple. I told you about the one with the furnaces that I found out just by opening two furnaces.
And if you don't, to explain what we're talking about, the people that have played, I'm sure you're familiar with having to pick the handprint and the three A's for the furnace. Well, Mike actually didn't see the note that was there.
I was like, I saw one of the furnaces without a name, and then the other one was just completely blank. One of them had like the handprint, so I just picked that one, and then the one that didn't have a name on it.
And then
it worked out.
And then for one of those molded, just pop out where it was. Like, the game does a great job, and I know one critique I'm seeing from a lot of reviewers is the lack of variety in the enemies. And I personally completely disagree of that being a con, just because I think the game is grounded to the point where it would be weird if we were just fighting like we're fighting like spider people one mission and one part, and then later we're fighting like bats or we're fighting like a vampire like zombie or something. Because like I like the fact that it really is you deal with the family and the molded. Because due to the story and what's happening with Evelyn, it makes perfect sense that it would just be these contained things. I like the fact that the entire situation is contained. Evelyn crashes on that ship with Mia, but it's all just around their property. No one else is being affected. And that makes the story for me that much more meaningful, because it really is really only affecting you, Mia, the family, and Evelyn and the organizations that follow. So those are pretty much our big takeaways. Obviously like I said the bosses were great. I thought the puzzles were awesome too. One thing we wanted to delve into this video, more spoilers of course, are some of the theories about the ending. So personally, I just want to say I think that last boss, Evelyn, they could have done a little more with her.
She was definitely an easy boss. Like I said, I only had like 5 bullets left in my gun, and I shot all just her shoot. Face.
It's almost to the point where it's not even like a boss battle. Yeah. I think it would have been cool personally if they really would have stretched out the idea of her pushing you out the house. If you maybe like you really had to like grab the door and push up and then go up the stairs. Also the foreshadowing that Evelyn is a grandmother is awesome. Because when you replay the game, you're getting all this foreshadowing that you didn't even realize was foreshadowing until, of course, it's revealed.
I thought it was funny how I jokingly said that she was going to be the boss.
Yes. Because he saw the picture and he was joking, like, watch, the grandma's going to be the boss. And turns out he was correct.
I didn't even see the picture. I just figured.
Oh, I didn't see the picture, yeah.
She has no other point. She's just there.
Yeah, she was just game. There. Just another so, I mean, random
what
room.
What else is she going to be part of? She's going to come to the story sooner or later.
Yeah. So. And ending talk, I will say, because we're already talking about ending, that's my only real critique of the game is the third act is very sloppy.
Yeah.
Just because
it throws a lot at you.
Yeah, because the serum. So the serum thing was with Mia and Zoe. I appreciate you get a choice. I guess you get to role play a little bit in Ethan's situation. Like, do I help someone, part of the family that can maybe, you know, really help the situation more than Mia? Or because you don't know who Mia is, which she's actually part of an organization opposed to umbrella? Or do I help Mia, my wife? You know, do I cure her? But then you think of all the things she's done and how she's kind of kept stuff from you. The problem is, if you pick Zoe, you get on a boat and she dies for no reason. And then Mia somehow wakes up at the shipwreck.
Yeah, it doesn't even explain
how, she gets there. It doesn't make any sense. So the canon ending is Mia picking Mia because you go with her and they crash. So that was a little sloppy. They should have.
You also save her at the end of the game.
Yes. Actually.
And y'all start over again.
Actually, do you know the difference in. So whenever you're in that steam room, if you picked Zoe, you killed Mia. You kill her there. You kill her in the with the axe. But if you pick Mia, she sacrifice. She gives you
the blood and then locks the door.
Yes, and that's different because that, and that was one change I thought was cool, is that Mia actually dies if you pick Zoe. But yeah, all they had to do was add a simple cutscene to show that how Mia got there, because she doesn't look like she would chase you at all. She's actually mad when you pick Zoe, because she's like, you betrayed me.
Well, and even Zoe's mad when you
pick Zoe. They're both mad, because they're like, oh, well, I'm going to die here. Thanks a lot.
Pretty much.
Even though, why did Zoe... Zoe gave you two serums, and obviously Jack is still there. So why... What was she thinking was going to happen? Because you're always going to have to use it on Jack, but that's fine. Now, let's get into theories. There is a theory. One is that the boss with Jack, the final Jack boss, quote unquote, with him being a giant monster, is actually Lucas and Jack. I didn't give you that theory, but that is one that I read, that Jack and Lucas are actually kind of combined.
I thought Lucas wasn't infected, though.
See, that's another one. See, so all these theories are going to kind of overlap each other because they have conflicting things, because they just are a theory. There is a theory that Lucas is not actually infected. He's actually mind controlled.
But see, I don't see how Lucas couldn't be infected if he got his arm chopped off at the beginning of the
game. That is true, and that is one thing that kind of gets rid of that theory. I think people are just saying
he was pulling his nails out.
Oh yeah, and he talks about the gift.
Yeah, and he says, "I don't want to go back."
Yeah, that is cool. The character, and yeah, I don't know why that was a theory. The characterization for each character is great because Jack obviously doesn't like this. Margaret doesn't like how they are, but Lucas is the bad seed of the family. He enjoys.
Yeah, there's that scene where it's like Jack and Zoe, and I guess you're like
in a hive mind, you're kind of like have like a psychic connection with them. And yeah, he's basically
in the living room, and he's like asking you for help.
Yes, he's asking for help, and he genuinely, and you really feel bad because it really is kind of a sad story.
Kind of sad,
and but with Lucas, what's cool is if you read the notes in his room, he's a demented kid. He already was, and this gift literally just allowed him to do worse. So that was a cool little characterization for Lucas because he doesn't want to go back. He enjoys being, you know, this almost immortal being that's just killing people. Another theory, this is just a small one, people kind of thought the first aid was strange in that the fact that you literally just pour it on yourself and you're fine. It could have just been a style choice. It could have just been like, okay, well, it's first person, let's just, you know, have this little animation for the health. But some people think that the first aid is actually has some type of part of the virus in it.
Yeah, the bacteria.
Yes, part of the bacteria, and it's actually affecting Ethan when he uses it. But it's also healing him, obviously, because the regenerative abilities there. The reason why people think that is because there is an optional scenario that if you basically don't get away from Jack when you're going into the hatch near the beginning of the game, he can actually grab you and cut your leg off. And when that happened to me my first playthrough, I'm like, what the heck? Why am I just losing my limbs?
That happened to me too.
Yeah, like, why am I just losing my limbs? And he actually toys with you.
He rolls you the bottle.
So
he's like, here, put it back on.
So this is very much like something he's at least tampered with. He's messed with. So yeah, the theory is that you're actually infecting yourself as you use the healing. And I don't know if Capcom would go that far, but that is a cool
really
idea.
Never really like shows any signs of that though.
Well, the idea is you wouldn't be able to see the grandma if you weren't infected. You wouldn't be able to see Evelyn, the girl, period, if you weren't infected, because the notes talk about how the organization can't see her. Mia could see her because she was infected. She was basically on there. She was a caretaker simply because she could see her. And that's why the guy, her partner agent, that's why he's like looking around. He can't see what's going on, but she can.
I guess that makes sense.
And so yeah, Ethan might be infected, and that explains why he's able to just lose his hand, and get it back. And so that's theories as far as stuff in the game. Now let's get to the actual ending. So if you've played the game, you do know that the returning character for Resident Evil is Chris. Now, personally for me, I kind of saw it coming just because based on how 6 ended and how the game pretty much confirms this is very much after 6. This is the latest story. Yeah,
well, the game takes place in 2017.
Yes, it came in 2017. So this is the latest increment of Resident Evil story. So yes, we see it's Chris. Micah actually showed me that the umbrella logo is different. It's blue. So some people were saying like, oh, it's a prequel. I don't think it's a prequel because it's set in 2017. Yeah. But people were saying like, oh, you know, it was blue before. I don't know if it was blue before. I think people just made that up. But
I've always seen the umbrella logo be red.
Yeah, it is red. People were saying like, oh, in the first one it was blue. I don't think that. I played the first one. I don't think it was blue. But yeah, so a couple things that's weird. First of all, Chris Redfield in the lore of the series, he's very much against Umbrella. I don't know why he'd work for them. What's interesting is Ethan does seem to say it took you guys long enough, which kind of, for me personally, kind of hints that he maybe had some type of connection to Umbrella, which might explain why he was married to Mia, maybe like a Mr. and Mrs. Smith situation when they're on opposing organizations trying to get more intel from each other. And that might be stretching it, but I could totally see that happening.
But like I said before, why would Chris Redfield be introducing himself if Ethan works for Umbrella?
That might be true. Maybe Chris is new. Maybe Ethan was only like in a scientist position. Maybe he didn't know all the but that could be stretching it. But you know, then hopefully the Not a Hero DLC, which is a free DLC coming out in the spring, will elaborate more on that. But yeah, so we see Chris, and it's just strange because yeah, it just doesn't make sense. It's kind of like Batman, you know, working with Joker. It's strange. It's just like that. Why would that happen? And one theory is that it actually might be Hunk, and this might not actually be the real Chris Redfield. Now, in the credits, it does roll and say Chris Redfield as a voice actor, so maybe it is Chris, or they don't want us to know it's not Chris yet, so they're putting Chris Redfield. But Hunk is this very elusive, basically Spec Ops agent that's part of Umbrella.
He's a mercenary.
Yeah, mercenary for Umbrella, and people don't really know who he is. They just know he's a very good agent, and there has been speculation in the past that it could be Chris, but this might actually elaborate more on that idea. Or they just wanted to make Chris look less of like a meathead, because in Resident Evil 5, he definitely looks...
Oh my god.
He looks so jacked, it's ridiculous. So maybe they just wanted some more like artistic freedom for Chris. But yeah, that's as far as theories for the ending, that's pretty much it. I think it's a cool little tie-in to Resident Evil fans. It's definitely not... it's not too much, which I appreciate. I would have hated if they, like, you know, flew to find Wesker or something. But you do use Wesker's gun, which is neat, the Albert, which is a cool little tie-in. And another thing they did is they also have a newspaper in the... I forgot where it is. It's somewhere near the end of the game that shows that Raccoon City is still messed up. And that's kind of a cool little tie-in to Resident Evil 2.
I think I saw the newspaper, actually.
So that is a cool little shout-out to Resident Evil 2, which is my favorite Resident Evil game. Speaking of that, as far as ranking it, I've been thinking about it for a while. And this might be my second or third favorite Resident Evil game in the series. Resident Evil 2 is still probably going to be up there. Yeah, it might be nostalgia, or it might just be that game is fantastic. But 7 is definitely up there, and I was excited for this game, but if you would have told me that it would be that chart that high on the scale of the Resident Evil games for me, I would be very surprised, just because I am a stickler. I'll admit it. And they managed to keep what's great about the series and reinvent it. And And the fact that someone like Micah, who hasn't played a Resident Evil game in like full, can enjoy it without having any like, you know, outside information about what's going on or what he should be looking for what's a good Resident Evil game, that says something.
Yeah.
And the fact that Capcom was able to pull in newcomers and welcome them in the series and also satisfy those hardcore fans that are looking for a certain degree of quality for a Resident Evil game, I think it's a knockout. They did a fantastic job. And yeah, that pretty much wraps up our discussion. Please let us know what you think. Did Resident Evil 7 live up to your anticipations? Are you looking forward to the DLC? Did you play the banned footage DLC? Did you enjoy that? I've yet to play that. I need to. I'll get on that. I'll get on that soon. And yeah, tell me, leave in the comments also any theories that you thought of or you've seen, and I'd love to get in the comments and talk to you guys about that. And yeah, thanks for watching, and this has been The Juice, and we'll see you later.
Guys later.